you just tell them, you're Bill Keith, get up and film everybody. Throw your weight around, man. How many guys in that line played with Bill Monroe? One of the most innovative banjo players who has ever lived, Bill Keith. Yeah! I parked my car next to where Bill was, and so that's how come I feel lucky to have found him and asked him to do this. So we have no idea what we're about to do or play.
No, we don't. Let's shake on.
So, talk Mike and
well, this will work.
Okay. An entire approach to a musical instrument. Paganini revolutionized the approach to the violin, and Earl Scruggs revolutionized the banjo the first time, and Bill Keith revolutionized the banjo the second time. And I'll, as Ralph Stone would say, I'm going to keep bragging on you here for a minute. Okay. What would you like to play? Okay, we're going to play that standard universally played banjo and fiddle duet, Autumn Leaves. Thank you. Now, that is almost, I think my understanding of banjo is limited, but isn't that nearly physically impossible to play those kind of chords on a banjo tuned in open tuning?
No, actually, the three strings are just like guitar. And then the top string, thank you, Matt. The top string.
No, I have this one.
The top string, you can just change the position a little, but I don't know, I don't. It seems like the top range is about the same as guitar, so it ought to be there.
Do you do any stuff with retuning the instrument?
Yeah, I don't have the reflexes in other tunings, so I learn set pieces.
What's another one? Do you play like Tico Tico or something like that? Did you used to play that? Or?
Here's a funny tuning that we asked about. I haven't had it. I can remember.
Of a string quartet. A string quartet is a good violinist, a bad violinist, an ex-violinist, and somebody who hates violins. It's a little bit esoteric. Did I ever show you? I made up a series of banjo joke cards. Did you ever see that? Really? Illustrated banjo jokes. I ran out.
Yeah.
I think Bill Monroe said something about he wouldn't have an electric bass in his band. Shouldn't we honor that? I think we should storm the stage and unplug the guy's bass, wherever it is.
Let's go.
Any questions for Bill, Keith, or Matt Glaser? Any gifts for Bill, Keith, or Matt Glaser? Come on in out of the sun. There's plenty of room here. Avoid the sun at all costs. Yes, sir.
Bill, what made you want to learn jazz?
Yeah, I guess the first banjo playing I heard actually was Dixieland music. Later, I was attracted to the sound of the banjo by some music. I didn't know what they called it. And when I went out looking for records, what I found was Dixieland. And that's sort of the first stuff I actually heard, even though I found out later what I had heard was Bill Monroe's recording of Cheyenne.
Well, let's play that.
Recording.
This is one of these great Bill Monroe tunes with it's like a standard. It has an A part in G minor with atmospheric Indian sounds, and then a B part that's kind of like swingy chord changes. Crossing the Catskills versus crossing the Cumberlands. Do you play either of those tunes?
I don't know, really. I'm not sure. I don't know either of them. I don't even suspect crossing the Catskills.
I just got a book of Yogi Berra-isms. It was a very hot day like today, and he was about to give a speech, and the mayor's wife said to him, "Yogi, you look so cool." And he said to her, "You don't look so hot yourself." What time is it?
I don't have a
what time is it? It's 2 o'clock. It's 1 o'clock. Quarter to 2?
Stay for 15 more minutes, we'll double your salary.
What key is you do back home again?
Any key you want, actually.
Yeah, in A flat, they call it Donna Lee.
Here's one of the great classic old standards called Back Home Again in Indiana.
Yeah.
Dog shows, funerals, bar mitzvahs, variety of functions.
If you hadn't done that any three times, I wouldn't have got it the right one.
We'd like to have a dialogue with the audience at this point in the program. Any questions? More questions, thoughts? Yes.
Well, thank you first. This is a pretty standard banjo of the Gibson style. It's made by Richard Taylor. It does have a coolish general ring in it. Although there are a lot of real good banjo rings out there, and I think it's the setup more than anything else. I keep the heavier loose. You know, it's tuned down to about an E. And they tell me it doesn't record well, but hey, I don't record all that much. It's like a great big sound. And trying to get the head real tight, it gets into too much of that sort of papery sound. Well, that has more to do with intonation than tone, but it corrects for the tendency for the third string to note flat or sharp up the neck. If you got the first and fifth right, the third, or for some mechanics, and it seems to be different from one banjo to another. I've seen some banjos, a couple of Gibsons that were perfect intonation with a straight bridge, but this one, if with a straight bridge, the third string will not note sharp, will note very sharp. It needs the third string.
If you ever want to have an amazing afternoon, call up Bill Keith and ask him about tuning and temperament systems and the history of Western tuning and temperament. It's totally mind-boggling. You want to go into a brief diatribe about that now, or actually, maybe better not.
It's a little too mathematical.
This fiddle is an American fiddle made by a guy from Indiana named Pixbutt. I don't know who he is, but he carved his wife's name in the headstock.
Pixbutt.
Pixbutt.
Back home in Indiana.
And his wife's name was Rosemary, and he carved her name in the headstock, or for all I know, she carved her name in the headstock. Who knows what stories you could concoct about this. But I bought it from my violin teacher, and it also doesn't record very well. Somebody was telling me yesterday about overtone systems and how the more complicated and interesting a sound is, the more hard to define it is. The tone doesn't just end, it's kind of grainy at the edge of the border. So it's hard to play in tune on this violin. I know a poor craftsman blames his tools, but it's hard to play in tune, but it also has a really neat, weird kind of raspy. I like this, a lot of air coming out of a violin, a lot of sound hitting me back in the face. You know. Do you have one more question, yes? That's a very good question. Daryl is fond of saying that in terms of a violin, the picture of the sound of the violin doesn't become apparent until some feet away, and it's common to record most instruments relatively close. So if you do some combination of distant miking and close miking and then balance them, you might be able to get an accurate sound. But these are extremely subjective things, these good tone things. A classical violinist, oftentimes a great classical violin will say, you know, these people pay $500,000 for their instruments, and then when you stand right next to them, they sound terrible. But they sound really great at the back of a huge hall without a microphone they can project over an orchestra. Whereas the ethos of sound in bluegrass and country fiddling is different, and that's different again in swing fiddling. So it depends on the music and what is the sound ethos. That's a really good violin sound coming off the stage now. Who's playing there now? Who are they? Oh, yeah, I know that guy. Sure, I know that fiddler. What's his name? I didn't know. Any final questions before we depart? We want to thank you very much. You've been a very kind audience who came to see something that they didn't expect and didn't demand their money back. And it's been nice to see Bill again and hang out with him here for an hour.
Matt Glaser on the fiddle. You'll catch him later, we hope, with David Greer and Daryl Andrews. And the veteran, Bill Keith. Thanks a lot for filling in today. Coming up next on the Homespun Diderio Workshop stage, Roy Bookbinder is going to stop by in just a few minutes. So stick around.
Well, I started playing guitar when I heard the Reverend Gary Davis, and I heard this song, and the syncopated guitar tickled my ear. I didn't realize it was going to ruin my life. No home videos, please. That's how we make a living, we sell them.
I didn't hear that joke. Security.
Next up here on the Homespun Diderio Workshop stage, Mike Munford, who's going to be playing tonight with Peter Rowan, and the veteran of bluegrass, Bill Keith.
Hey, well, thank you. Thank you all for coming. I'm glad to be up here with Mike. You know, I've known Mike for a lot of years, and always admired his playing, and it's rare to have him up here at Winterhawk with a chance to have him play directly for us, so whereas I sure enough a lot at this event, it's in my backyard, so to speak, so you heard a lot of me, so I'm just going to sit around and listen to Mike. I'll back you up on that.
Okay, let's just play Let's try a little Scruggs classic Shuck in the Corn. good way to kick off an afternoon. I like that. Thanks, Bill.
You know, one of the Mike will be playing tonight with Peter Rowan as told during the introduction, and I love Peter's real hard driving bluegrass style. Mike's banjo player fits right in there. You do a lot of the fiddle tune arrangements too that I particularly enjoy. A lot of stuff I don't know, and I'd like to hear you play some.
Yeah, I'll take a couple of tunes like Katie Hill's one of my favorites, which is a great old fiddle tune, has a very infectious melody. I always love it. It's a very old-time tune. At almost any tempo, it's a great sounding piece of music. So maybe we could try it a little slow and old-timey and kind of pick it up.
Sure. In fact, I might just back it up.
Okay, that's fine. Sure. Katie Hill.
Like that tune, just a catchy old fiddle tune.